Hello and welcome back to MyExcelOnline.com. Today we are going to go over the let function. The let function is available in Excel 365 and it's just another reason to subscribe to Microsoft Office 365 because you get all these cool updates with really nice new functions that allow you to be more efficient in Excel. Two of the benefits of the let function include improved performance. It's actually a more efficient function. And also better readability. Hopefully by the end of this lesson, you will be able to see that it is much easier to navigate through the let statement than it is to go through a nested if type of statement. The let function takes three arguments. The first argument is the name of the variable that you're inputting into your function. The second argument is the name value, which is the value of that variable. And the third argument is the calculation that is being done with this variable. You will see as we go on that you can actually enter more than one variable into the let function. So what that would look like is the let function with the first argument being name and the second argument being name value. But then the third argument could be name two for a second variable and name value two for the value of that second variable and then the calculation. And then you could do the same thing for a third variable and a fourth variable all the way up to 126 variables. So just think of how complicated of a statement you can make using the let statement if you're going to use 126 variables. But for our purposes for today, what I've done is I have created a spreadsheet and I'm going to show you the difference between using one variable with a let statement and using five variables with a let statement. So here's the spreadsheet we're going to be working with today to more fully understand the let function versus nested if. I have in column C the expected output of my manufacturing plant and in column D I have the actual output. So there's a discrepancy between these two numbers, and that's what column E is. It's the percent difference. How much did I actually produce over how much I expected to produce? So with these numbers, I would like to give some kind of immediate feedback where if this difference is a low number, such as less than 0.8, then I'm going to return the word bad. Or if this number is over 100%, which means I made more than I had expected to make, then I'm going to put down the word good and show that this was a really productive day at our company. So let's quickly review how I would have done this as a nested if. Remember, the if function takes three arguments. The first argument is a logical test. The second argument is the value if the logical test is true. And the third argument is the value if the logical test is false. So right here, I'm going to type equals if this difference right here is greater than one, then I want to return the word good in double quotes. Otherwise, I want to do a second if statement if, left parenthesis, the value in E3 is less than 0.8, then I want to return the word bad. Otherwise, I want to return a double quote. Make sure I close enough parentheses here and hit enter. So in this case here, nothing is being returned, and that is correct because I do not want anything that is between 0.8 and 1. So I'm going to go over here and double click the bottom right hand corner so that the formula can be copied all the way down. So when I look, I will see the words bad and good. Let me see my first bad, 0.55. Yes, that's actually way less than 0.8. And go to my first good, that is over a 1. So that is why this word good is showing up. Just a very quick basic nested if. Now I'm going to click in cell F2 and I'm going to use the let function this time. So that's going to look like this, equals let with a left parenthesis. The first value I want to put in here is the name of my variable. I'm going to call it PCHG because that means percent change. And then I'm going to put a comma. Now, what is the value of my percent change? In this case, it's going to be the value that's in cell E3. So I'm just going to click on E3 and hit a comma. And then what will my calculation be? In this case, I want an if statement. If, left parenthesis, my variable, the PCHG, is greater than 1, comma, I want to return the word good. Otherwise, I'm going to do that other nested if. If PCHG is less than 0.8, then I want to return the word bad. Comma for my otherwise, or my value if false. I'm going to do another double quote so nothing returns, and I'm going to close the right parenthesis. And I'm going to put two parentheses and hit enter. Again, I'm going to click on my formula, double click on the bottom right hand corner, and return all my values. And as you can see here, the let statement is doing the exact same thing as nested if. So if I go down here to 0.55, I will see that both are bad. If I go down here to 1.011, I will see that both are good. So the let statement is working exactly the same as the nested if statement. So in this case with one variable, it's really not that big of a deal whether or not you're using the let statement or the nested if statement. I just wanted to show you that they function essentially the same and that you really have a choice. If you are liking this video, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to get notifications of our new weekly Excel tips. Now for the really fun stuff. We are going to use 5 variables in this let statement. So over here, I've copied the same if statement into column G just so that we can compare and see what it's like to add several variables to the let statement. So let's look at our nested if and let's evaluate different variables that we could add to this equation. When I zoom into my formula bar, I see several different possibilities for variables. First of all, I see the variable for the difference. We just added that last time with a percentage change. We're going to keep that one. But I also see a variable for, how about this number 1? What if I want this number 1 to be able to be changed higher or lower in the future? That would be a good candidate for a variable. How about this word good here? That might be another good candidate for another variable. And so if those are good variables, then other good variables will be the number that I want to use for when I want this to be bad, as well as the word that I want to use when this is a bad or negative percent difference. So let me show you how to use that let statement to allow for 5 variables. I'm going to click in F2, type equals, the word let, and a left parenthesis. My first variable, I'm going to do PCHG again for percentage change and a comma, and I'm going to click in this cell because I'm still going to keep that percentage change. My next variable here will be what number do I want to put into this equation if the percent difference is good. So in this case, I'm going to put PERGOOD for percent good, and I'm going to put a comma, and this time I'm going to put a 1 because I still want anything over a 1 to be good. Going to put a comma, and now let's do my second variable, PER bad. What percentage do I want for bad? I'm going to put a comma and a 0.8. Now, what kind of text do I want for good? I'm going to call this variable TXTGOOD, and you can call this name anything you want it to be. Then I'm going to put a comma, and in double quotes, I'm going to put good, and then put a comma, and then I'm going to write TEXT bad, put a comma, and in double quotes, just write the word bad. And put a comma. Now I need to put in my actual calculation. What is this calculation going to be? It's going to be that if statement again with a left parenthesis. My logical test will be my PCHG. So if my PCHG is greater than my variable for being good, which is PERGOOD, then I want to put the word for TEXTGOOD. Otherwise, I'm going to have a second if statement in here. If left parenthesis, my logical test will again be my PCHG if that is less than my bad number, which is PERBAD. So if my percentage change is less than my percent bad, then what do I want to return? My TEXTBAD. Otherwise, I'm just going to put 2 double quotes because I don't want to return anything. Now I have some parentheses to close up here. 1, 2, 3 for my let statement. Now I'm going to hit enter and nothing is showing up, which is correct. So if I click back on my first cell and double click the bottom right hand corner to autofill everything below it, you will see that I am returning the exact same results for 5 different variables that I've allowed to go in here. Now just for fun, instead of putting the word bad in, I'm going to put an emoji. I don't know if you know how to do emojis in Excel, but I'm going to click over here and hit the Windows key and then a period, and this emoji window will show up. So in this case, if I hit period and start typing bad, the bad emojis will show up. So I'm going to do this thumbs down for bad and hit enter. If I hit the Windows key period with a smile for good, I can select the smile face for a good job and close that window. So now I have both the emojis that I would like to use over here. I'm going to click and highlight the thumbs down and hit Control C on my keyboard, then hit escape and go up here to my formula, and where it says bad, I'm going to highlight that word, leaving the double quotes because this emoji here is considered text, and I'm going to hit Control V and hit enter. I'm going to do the same thing for my good emoji. I'm going to highlight the emoji, hit Control C, hit escape, go back to my formula, and replace the word good with the emoji, leaving the double quotes. Now I'm going to press enter. If I go up to my column and go to the bottom right hand corner and double click so I can get the autofill for the formula for all the cells below it, you will see that I now have emojis in place of the word good and bad. I want to show you something else that's really fun. I'm going to go up to my let formula and I'm going to store this formula so that I can use it in the future and that I don't have to remember this entire let function. But before I do that, right now, column E is a relative reference. It will move just like any Excel formula does. If I were to move over one more column and copy this formula, it would move from E to F. And I don't want to do that. I want to lock down column E. So I'm going to put a dollar sign right before the E. And then I'm going to highlight this entire function and hit Control C to copy the function. And then I'm going to hit Enter. Next, I'm going to go to the Formula tab and hit Name Manager. And I'm going to click the new button. And I'm going to type here display emoji. You can type in any name that you want here, but this is going to become the name of the function that you will be able to use later on inside of your spreadsheet. So you can call this whatever you want. But refers to, I'm going to paste in that let function. One more option on here is the scope. Do you want to only be able to call out this function name within this workbook? Or you could even limit it just to one of these tabs inside of the workbook that you are working with. But for now, I'm just going to choose workbook and click OK. And I need to remember right here the word display emoji. So I'm going to hit close. And then I'm going to click in H3 and type equals display emoji and hit enter. Right now, I'm not returned with anything. I'm going to double click on the bottom right hand corner for the autofill. And you will see that that formula has also been copied into this column. And I'm using the same exact let function over here, so I can actually use this all over my spreadsheet without having to retype it because I used this name manager up here. And that allows me to reuse essentially any function that I'm using in Excel. So in review, we looked at the let function. We contrasted the let function with the nested if function using one variable. And then we looked at the let function using five variables. We also put in emojis instead of using the word good or bad. And then we went over the name manager on how to be able to use functions and call them out anywhere in the rest of your spreadsheet. Hopefully you learned a lot about the let function today. If you have any questions on this, please leave a comment below. Thanks for watching our video and see you again next time.
If you like this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you're really serious about advancing your Microsoft Excel skills so you can stand out from the crowd and get the jobs, promotions, and pay rises that you deserve, then click up here and join our Academy online course today.